liberalization and privatization. So basically, globalization had a promise that it will bring together people and it will lead to more happy lives. But right since 1995, and of course, there have been analysts even before that talking about, all the economic institutions which are established to promote globalization. So the discussion basically, and the promise was that everyone will have a happy life based on a commoditization, and then happy life on consumption. I think that was the promise which globalization established. And but if you look at since 1995, after Dunkel draft and all that, WTO was established. From 1995 up to 2020, we can see a series of changes which led to the weakening of globalized economies, especially developed countries like US, Britain, France, Australia, New Zealand, many other countries, including Norway, Netherlands. So there was a debate which has begun in this decade, in the beginning of this decade, and which has increasingly questioning this model, primarily from two perspectives. One, how it has led to inequity, a vast inequity where only 1% of the global population getting wealth and happiness, and then the other 99% is struggling with very, very low resources. That's one perspective. And second is, the earlier economic model where consumption leading to equity. Basically, consumption, everyone will be able to consume whatever they want. I mean, that kind of argument was proffered, and that is being questioned. And third, we have seen the resource depletion. As you mentioned rightly, the world commons, especially the oceans and the Arctic, Antarctica, and also the global atmosphere and the climate change. I think these changes are increasingly questioning this model of globalization and the way of living, which has been promoted through that argument. So I think these three perspectives are now forcing. And then the final nail, I think, came from COVID-19. Basically, it has destabilized with one go by lockdown, forcing a lockdown on every economic activity across the world, and then creating a panic situation, so which has stopped production, which has stopped communication, which has stopped transport, which has stopped many activities which are detrimental to environment and ecology. I think all these brought together a new kind of thinking. Even though in climate change negotiations and international parties and scholars have been saying climate change needs, it is reminding again and again that we need to step back from fossil fuels. We have to decarbonize our activities. We have to increasingly become more ecology friendly. But no one was listening. I think COVID-19 forced a stoppage of all such activities. So now in this scenario, I think, as you rightly said, Earth governance has come to the fore. And then how we want to rebuild our future. I think that is now under debate. So many perspectives are coming up, but basic premises of what there were is being questioned. I think we can go into detail also. If you look at the last 100 years, especially before World War One and between the two world wars, and then the World War Two, and then the World War Two and the Cold War conditions, and after Cold War, the complete debate on globalization. I think these are the phases which have defined world history and world political system. So global governance increasingly was shaped by these events or unfortunate incidents, and then the entire capitalist system which was built on this. I think these are the factors which are now under scrutiny. And an important aspect, I think, which is again coming up, which was there before, even when League of Nations was there, people brought technology as a factor. At that time, technology is different, and the current technology which we are discussing is different. So when the League of Nations was established, people thought technology is moving, I mean, creating conditions for such a cooperation. But I feel technology increasingly became a divisive tool as well, even though it looks like a facilitating tool. But I think socially, culturally, and economically, technology has also been used to divide societies and divide governance systems and keep the world apart. So nuclear weapons, you can see nuclear weapons as one such example where people build their political egos that they have nuclear weapons and they can do anything, or they can threaten the neighboring countries or fellow countries. So I think technology as a factor is coming up again in the modern day today. So I think we need to constantly keep this factor under observation and see how this is going to contribute or distort the Earth governance system which we are trying to look at.
As you rightly said about the need or the origin of this kind of the thought process on the common global governance, that is the Earth governance. It had been there since very old times. Historically, people had been tried to rule the world, like Alexander the Great, he tried. Like that, many kings have tried to consolidate and then have a common governance. That was mostly like power or their own benefit. And there were various other reasons. But now, in the present context, especially in the 1945, when now we will be celebrating 75 years of the formation of United Nations. So this is an historic thing, and which sustained longer, we can say, with the 193 countries as members. But still, there are so many differences and challenges within United Nations and various of its wings. But still, it played an important role globally, and there is something for every country to represent themselves in this common organization. But people are not looking at organizations per se, but they want this Earth governance, a kind of system. And this thought process is taking very much shape and strength in the last 20, 25 years. Various countries are working. Otherwise, also, there are some subgroups are forming, or let us say, regional groups are also forming. Let us say, BRICS, it represents some of the most powerful countries, a kind of groups, or G20, or different nations are there. Even European Union is one network of their own and having their own constitution in common, apart from the national constitutions. Of course, the regional diversities, regional challenges, regional governance, that has to be taken care. As a political scientist, you also know this, that equity is one aspect where we need to really focus on the leftover people and the regional developmental issues, because uniformly we don't have development. So for that reason, the regional policies or the constitutions or governance is one aspect. But common governance, which is impacting this COVID-19, is one pandemic which has become a global. It has the multiplier effect, actually, dominoes effect. So it has triggered all the sectors and areas of governance, and even the political debacle, it's happening. And that's one of the biggest challenge now. And global leadership is also under question. So it means we don't have such common systems to take care of this kind of situations, which is not pertaining to a geography, but it is relevant to the global challenges. So of course, the peace, human rights, and sustainable development goals, these had been the core issues of United Nations, and they had been doing fairly well in promoting these things. And all nations are participating and trying to achieve them. Apart from that, focused issues like climate change, then a convention on biological diversity, even on desertification. So these are also other focused issues. And all other wings like FAO, UNESCO, and many other, even peace corps within this peacekeeping force, like that, many other things there, even economic and social affairs wing of UN, even international migrants issues. So like that, many things the UN is looking at. But still, I don't think the role that UN need to play in bringing this integrity among the nations, or understanding, and this common governance issues, we have definitely failed, including the seas, the maritime issues, all the seas have been depleted or degraded due to this over-mining or fishing, and many other challenges are there. So I think there is a need to look with a different perspective how we need to go into the future with common goals and common agenda. So in this regard, what do you think the role of UN especially? Do we need to rethink how, especially the Security Council, giving the power to only five nations, veto power especially. That is always a discussion point. The countries waiting, like Japan, India, Germany, like they want to become part of the Security Council. Still, it doesn't represent the global interest, because they can use this one as their own personal this thing also. So there are so many other challenges still existing. So how do you see the role of UN in this whole scenario?
Actually, you raised two, three important discussion point. One is a common system. I think presently, to make a comment on the United Nations, you know, when it was formed in 1945, it was basically formed based on certain rules which were agreed by only a few nations. And over a period, I think it got expanded, and various other nations were brought into the fold of UN system. But over a period, I think during the Cold War conditions and later on, this rule-based UN body gradually became weaker and weaker. Now, it was made weaker by these same forces which brought it to the international stage. So I see that happened during Cold War, when the Soviet Union and the United States and the NATO bloc, they had politics between them. And United Nations at that time could play only facilitating role, not in those areas, but in other areas where this Cold War politics were not in such a deeper involvement as such. So there is a viewpoint which says the decolonization which happened post 1945 and up to 1970s, this is because of United Nations. But I don't agree it happened because of the democratic agitations and the movements happened in each of the country, and then the priorities of the colonizing nations has changed, and they thought capitalism is a better way of colonization or resource colonization. So I feel now, so whatever might be the pros, cons, advantages and disadvantages of United Nations, right now I would look at it as a large civil society organization rather than a rule-based regulatory global governance institution. Now, if you look at along with United Nations in the last 25 years, we have a set of economic and financial institutions which are developed, especially Bretton Woods institutions like World Bank, International Monetary Fund, so various other banks, Asian Development Bank. So all these banking and financial system, I think they also contributed to this weakening of United Nations as a governance model. But these institutions themselves became weakened, I think, once the WTO came, and then the trading became a priority, and then the inherent weaknesses in this capitalist mode of production and consumption. So today, World Bank and IMF are also relooking at their models of development. Of course, there have been a lot of agitations, a lot of papers, scholarly work, which are questioned World Bank and the Bretton Woods institutions. The third set is we are looking at what you mentioned as regional cooperation movements like BRICS, SAARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, NATO, OECD. So you have various regional groupings which were built probably to either sustain the initiatives taken under this Bretton Woods institutions or WTO or other multilateral initiatives. Secondly, some of the like G77, I think all these are built upon a economic perspective. I'm keeping on coming back to that economic perspective, which took off from 1945. That economic perspective is what it looks at is resource exploitation, mineral mining, and then consumption. I think this cycle, the cycle of natural resource consumption, I think that has been the core value on which all these institutions have been built. So even regional movements, when they talk of power, from emerging powers, rising powers, I think all this have been defined based on the economic models which mimicked the developing country, developed country models. So everything was, what we look at it as a monocropping system in agriculture. So it was a monocropping kind of economic model all over, and all the cooperations, regional bodies, and get-togethers were all built on that perspective. So when the capitalism itself is inherently getting weakened, where the production system is under questioning. And if you look at, in the last 25 years, once globalization has come, we have built this global value chain system. So you have supply chain systems, which starts from a poor country and which delivers a product to a rich country. So you can look at it, agriculture products or textile and clothing. So you can name any product, you can look at how they were manufactured, produced, or formulated in a poor country, and then they reach the consumers in a rich country or to a richer class. I think these supply chain models, try to replace the earlier factory mode of production and try to distribute production, but consumption was not distributed because both these models are dependent on a viewpoint that paying, you pay and you get your consumption or get your product or get your service. I think these are the models on which these regional groups are also built, and they try to legitimize that kind of production model. Now, where these few people have failed, you can look at it. If you look at waste, the trade, waste trade all over the world, the huge mountains of waste which are produced by this model is again coming back to poor countries, or they are contaminating the global commons. So you can see ships, waste ships with hazardous waste moving all over the world in oceans, and all that waste is dumped in somewhere in the no man island in the oceans, or on the islands where there's no jurisdiction, or in poor countries. So the commons, world commons, have been completely destroyed by this consumptive model, and none of the institutions or regional cooperative agreements or groupings, they were able to influence, or they were able to regulate or reduce this kind of global commons from getting depleted or contaminated or destroyed. I think that's where these institutions have failed. And when you look at even chemicals management, we have three, four conventions, we have institutions, but they are far more resource poor than in comparison with World Trade Organization, which is built on trade. So chemicals management globally did not develop into a complete cooperative model because their resources have been very poor, and United Nations or these regional groupings neglected strengthening those processes. So you have numerous conventions. Now, you mentioned human rights. We have a Human Rights Council at international level. We have a number of human rights bodies. But when you look at how multinational companies continue to exploit, continue to violate human rights, continue to destroy ecological rights, none of these institutions or regional cooperation is able to regulate them. Even though I've been involved in the past few years on developing a covenant on business and human rights, but the struggle to regulate, the struggle to rein in these multinational companies, I think it's still a lost case. So there I can see UN Security Council is not able to do anything. You can see WTO not being able to do anything. And the entire conventions, Stockholm Convention or various other chemical conventions, even they are not able to rein in them. My viewpoint is when we are discussing climate change, where increasingly I know rogue nations and leaders who are now considered as rogues, who are refusing to acknowledge the climate change, refusing to acknowledge the factors which are contributing to that global climate change. Especially you can look at recently Brazil, where Amazon forests in thousands of acres have burnt, and the president of Brazil said this is their right to do, and they want development which is a conventional development model. So the president of Brazil is not alone. There are many other countries. Almost every nation has a prime minister or a president who tends to overlook the climate change, which is imposing a very disastrous consequences on the planet. So how do we rein in them? How do we regulate them? United Nations, I don't see from the history or from the current situation where it is dependent on funds from each of the country, and most countries have stopped funding or reduced their funds only because their interests have not been served. Their economic interests have not been served. Their narrow ecologically damaging interests have not been served. In that context, I would like to look at a Earth governance system which is much broader and which puts ecology first, climate change next, and then environmental conservation as the third factor. And how do we bring this? I think that is one issue which should be in our concern right now.
Yeah, you have covered elaborately all the aspects. Some of the most pressing challenges currently is the global population. So I think UN, although there is a wing to look after this population aspects, it is also not able to really influence the nations to contain this population growth. That is one big challenge. Coming to human rights, the issue in America recently, globally we have seen based on color, caste, creed, religion, like that, there are so many discriminations already happening. And these migrations related to this kind of, including the challenges like natural, like recurring droughts or climate change, which are influencing geographically. Apart from that, this religious persecution or caste, creed, religion, and other discriminations, that is also leading to this kind of mass migrations, mass exodus. And most important is the economic aspects. The social aspects is one aspect, but economic aspects like sanctions, the role of World Trade Organization, the, in the name of globalization, how some livelihoods are lost or some at the cost of environment, the production is happening that nobody is bothered. So again, these greenhouse gas emissions and all that that is happening. And all these challenges are also not taken care well in the whole process. Also, we have the so many other, including, let us say, FAO, the role in agriculture, especially the kind of GMOs or the seeds that are being introduced, or how the ecological implications are there. And all the sustainable development goals, even that Millennium Development Goals had been started, but in 2015, again, need to rethink because we have failed in achieving those things. And again, restarting again with Sustainable Development Goals. These are very holistic, and each nation need to achieve. But again, assigning the responsibility of each government to stand for, and especially when it comes to monitoring, this is very, very weak, or even submitting the indicators of the development. Again, the nations are unable to meet those things systematically. again revisiting this kind of common goals and reconstituting with the present situation, that is also required. And recently, most important, the health aspect is, of course, education is also most important. But health aspect has been totally in chaos now with this pandemic situation, including the nations which are having at least 10-20 times the per capita income. They are also unable to tackle the situation. What about the poor countries, including developing countries like India, where the per capita income is so low and the infrastructure is so poor? And what role did really WHO played in totally this managing this situation? That is still a big question. And nobody is satisfied with the role of WHO, not about India, but including the countries like European countries as well as the America, even the developed countries. They are not satisfied with the kind of tackling the situation or advisories that they could have given in time to prevent this kind of situation. And even now, all the countries are struggling to find a way out. And in between, again, the human rights issue cropped up again in America due to some incidents. But I think the total global recession, that is a big challenge that is ongoing. And how to tackle this current situation, and international trade will be a big challenge in this situation, as well as migration to other countries is also will be strongly curtailed. And even the international travels has been banned, and including this many other service sectors, dependent sectors like tourism or many other things, that is completely gone now. There is no way that those things can move. And the many retail industries, they are also under the doldrums. And I think we have a very big challenge in the history of mankind, especially human beings together. And in this particular situation, when United Nations in 1945 strongly came into existence, that was one reason for the need to exist. So there should be another reason why the things failed, and what could be the better organization, better governance, and better leadership. Without leadership, governance is not possible. For the emergence of this global leadership, we don't want these regional leaders taking decisions for the global governance. But we need the global leadership, common leadership as a humanity. Humanity doesn't mean just for human beings, but for all the life on this earth. How we can be responsible as trustees for this heritage, for this culture, for all the assets of the nature. How to give or take into the future, that is like future earth. So looking into future earth, how to transfer all this these things, heritage, our nature, culture, everything to the future generations. So I think that role and that kind of governance, earth governance systems need to emerge. So in this regard, as already had touched on some of the global commons which are highly depleted or which are now under threat. So similarly, on these aspects, you could reflect upon.
You brought in many more discussion points. One, you know, when I look at this politics over resources during colonization time and during decolonization time as well, that perspective of development or economic supremacy continued, and that's how now we are seeing a lot of resource depletion across the world, and at local level, regional level, country level, and global level. Now the conflict arising out of that resource depletion, and then the conflict to own those resources or consume those resources, is increasingly becoming sharp and more nearer. So this is one aspect which is continuously defining the politics all over the world, not only at a global level, but also at the local level. So at the long time back, I think this slogan that think global and act local was brought in this context of environmental conservation. So basically saying you need to act locally but think globally. But this was caught up many people and global citizens thought this is very apt to work upon. But this remained a slogan at people's level, but it was never imbibed by the decision makers and policy makers, especially at the global institutional level as well. So when you refer to international UN institutions, I think many of them, as I said earlier, they have become global civil society organizations, captive of their funding sources. So many funders today are multinational companies, and these multinational companies always push for technologies, research, and outputs which give them profits. So most international institutions are now shifting their agenda in tune with those dictations from the funding organizations. So that apart, I think recent sustainable development goals, I think this has emerged based on this global citizenry who believe in that think global and act locally. I think these sustainable development goals now hold a promise of a vision of bringing back the planet from the brink it is being pushed into. Now, one of the goals, I think SDG 17 talks about institutions and cooperation. Because all the changes, even from SDG 1 up to 16 and 18, I think they all require, rightly said by you, it requires leadership, it requires institutional building, it requires a vision, and it requires a change in perspectives. I think right now, the challenge is, how many leaders we have who can think within this framework of sustainable development goals, or simply think globally and act locally. Increasingly, on the other side, you are seeing leaders who are fighting for limited, finite, contaminated, or depleted resources. So I think that shift from a narrow resource-based thinking to a broader global resource conservation thinking, I think that is required, and how it is made possible is still a question, and how we can bring more and more people who can take up that leadership role. I think the earth leadership role, earth leader, I think that's that can be a vision, that can be a goal, that can be a focus, and we need to work on how we need to build those earth leaders, because right now I can't see, even at the international level, the so-called global leaders, I have not seen any of them talking at a global level. Their concern, either it could be a regional grouping, concern could be how a next project or a next fund will come, or a concern about how their country and how their power is not compromised. So I think we need require visionaries, we require global thinkers, we require earth leaders who can bring in or remodel institutions which can lead to earth governance democratically, and which can give more democratic space, leading to equitable usage of resources, and a sustainable cycle of production, consumption of resources. I think that is still a requirement, and that is how I feel Earth governance system needs to be modeled. So we are still looking for that person or a group of persons.
Yeah, you have stressed on the importance of Earth leadership. I think the Earth leaders are very much required now in the present situation. That is a kind of specially with that consciousness, especially the people who have lived at least in 2-3 countries in their lives. I think they will have a common consciousness of understanding about the global challenges. And the consciousness of this is the only home, Earth is the only home. We don't have, there is no planet B. And there are limitations. There are carrying capacity of the whole Earth. Not only that, it is not the human beings alone living on this Earth, but there are so much other life and so many resources which existed since millions of years. And exhausting them, we don't have that kind of authority to take over, including making this whole the world depleted with resources, and also this debt that is being carried into the future, future generations. We are actually borrowing things from the future generations who are not even existing. And this kind of scenario, these human beings have created with their own policies, their own means, are being mean, and the mean leadership are very narrow-minded or localized leadership. I think we as in the Earth Center and the Council for Green Revolution, we are working for the emergence of this Earth leadership, and hope with this kind of thought process that we have discussed elaborately on the challenges, global challenges, and we will strive for that Earth leadership existence and emergence, and that is what very much required. And I think today we have discussed elaborately on the various aspects of this Earth governance, and I thank you very much, Dr. Narasimha Reddy garu, and I will continue with our discussions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.